I'm running a $200 Amazon gift card the entire month of July. All you have to do to enter is like this video, be subscribed, turn on your notifications, and leave a comment why you want to win it with your Twitter handle attached. I will announce the winner at the end of the month on Twitter. A good horror game is a tough thing to do. Even tougher than that is to make the horror game community all happy. Almost impossible at times, and with such an objective thing like scariness, it can be tough to make something that everyone finds scary. Well, these games definitely did not do that. What's up, guys? Jimmy or Chaos, welcome to Chaos Top 10s, and today we are going to be going over 10 of the worst horror games that have ever been made. That's right, ever been made. They just sucked. They weren't scary. For whatever reason, they tanked. So turn on your notifications, click that little bell, check that box so you never miss an upload. I upload a brand new non-gaming top 10 every day at 3 o'clock and a brand new gaming like this one every night at 8 o'clock. So let's go over some really bad horror video games. Kicking off our list today at number 10, we are going to go with the game called Illbleed. And what's the nicest way to put this? It's a pile of garbage that was released in 2001 for the ill-fated Dreamcast. Rest in peace, Dreamcast. Illbleed was set in a demented amusement park and had an interesting concept, as you just couldn't rush through the levels despite the first-person view and the weapons. Much of the amusement park is booby-trapped and you had to proceed very carefully so do not get hurt by something that you couldn't see. And you can use your 4 senses, sight, sound, smell, and 6th sense to try and identify the traps. However, this slow and methodical style of game just made for a very, very boring gaming experience that was way too tedious to be fun or scary or both. Sure, the atmosphere is spooky and the mechanics are original and fresh, but none of that matters if the game ends up just being boring. Okay, at number 9, we have D. Yeah, the game is called D. Go ahead. Feel free to throw your jokes down in the comment section. I know they're coming. This was an interactive horror movie game released on April Fool's Day in 1995, which is honestly pretty fitting. You play as a woman as she goes to investigate a hospital that her father has barricaded himself in after going on a murderous rampage. D is a perfect example of a game that was praised upon release, but by today's standards, it's not very good. Sure, it has a place in gaming history as it pioneered some new mechanics and gaming technologies, but this game did not age well at all. And I'm pretty sure much of the critical praise back in the 90s came from people who were just impressed with the new technical capabilities of the title at that time. The game has since been ported to Steam, and it's only a few bucks, so if you have some time to spare, you can go try it out if you really, really want to, but I can't promise that you will have much fun with it. Taking our number 8 spot today is the game known as Geist. This is a first-person game for the Nintendo GameCube. After the excellent Sanity's Requiem, Geist was the second M-rated game to be released for the console. This game is very, very strange, though, as you played as a disembodied spirit and you possess other living things and use them to attack and kill enemies. I guess it's kind of a cool plot. The game was hyped up at E3 2003 after a surprise reveal by Nintendo, but once it came out 2 years later, that's right, 2 years after it was revealed at E3, the hype quickly faded as the game just wasn't very good. The mechanics were interesting, but the engine the game ran on was incredibly outdated already, leading to many technical problems like screen tearing, huge frame rate drops, and frustrating controls that made faster paced sections of the game almost infuriating, as it almost seemed like the controls couldn't keep up with what was happening on the screen. Geist concept probably could have been good, but thanks to the technical issues, bad graphics, and just overall disappointing final product, it wasn't scary and it wasn't fun. Next up, we have a PS2 exclusive that was released in 2003 known as Lifeline. Like other games on this list, Lifeline had an interesting new mechanic introduced during development: voice control. This game puts you in the shoes of the operator as you ventured around a space station after a group of monsters attack and murder almost everyone on board, leaving just you and a group of survivors to fight them off and try to stay alive. Sounds familiar, right? The game was a complete and utter failure. No one wants to play a horror game that requires you to use your voice as the controller, especially when the game itself is boring with characters and a microphone that barely works. Imagine having to use Siri as your controller in a horror game. That's basically what this game was. Some of you may have heard about this game. It's an old one, but we have Night Trap at number 6, and it was an incredibly controversial game released in 1992 for the Sega CD. Now, Night Trap was an interactive movie game, a genre that since has pretty much died out, but was basically a point-and-click adventure game that featured full live-action characters instead of computer-generated ones that you normally see in games. This aspect, though, is what made it so controversial. Despite most of all the violence happening off-screen, the use of real actors got the attention of the United States Senate. That's right, the actual Senate, who compared the game to Mortal Kombat and used it as an example of a game that would cause people to get violent in real life. And that promoted violence against women as well, to which the game creators were not happy about it at all, because it was plainly false and the accusations made by the Senate were blatantly unresearched and baseless. The controversy definitely didn't help Night Trap in terms of sales or critical reception, but neither did the fact that the game actually sucked. It was praised for innovating a new kind of gaming technology with the live-action sequences put in it, but the game itself was just terrible. The acting is horrible, it's super cheesy and not good in any way, and the game itself just, it was kind of boring. It has since gone down in gaming history as a cult classic thanks to the cheesiness, but come on, if we're being honest with each other, which we need to be here, the game sucks. Oh man, oh man, I remember this game. At number 5, Friday the 13th, not the new one. We're going all the way back to the NES version. When I say Friday the 13th game, I know most of you think about the online game that we're playing right now. We're not. We're talking about the horrible rendition, Friday the 13th, the game that came out in 1989 for the Nintendo Entertainment System. This game had you play as a new group of camp counselors at Crystal Lake as, guess what? You tried to survive as long as you could and fight off Jason, and is technically a sidequel to Friday the 13th Part 7. The game is absolutely atrocious. The music is super annoying. Jason is nearly impossible to kill, which makes sense, but the lore, come on, it's a game. It shouldn't be this hard. The visuals are gross, I guess, even by 1989 standards, and the gameplay is boring and repetitive, and it's probably the least scary game on the entire list. Other games on this list are bad, but at least they have a decent scare or two. Not this game. The game is bad, and I think Jason runs around in a tracksuit, which makes no sense at all. I hate putting anything from this franchise on a negative list, but I must. At number 4, we have Resident Evil 6. Now, Resident Evil has fallen a long way since the beginning. Thankfully, Resident Evil 7 was able to get the franchise back on its feet, but as much as Capcom wants you to forget about RE5 and 6, they're just too bad not to talk about. RE5 wasn't necessarily a horrible game, it was just below average and not really what RE fans wanted. But RE6 was flat out terrible. Since the series has been starting to go more action-oriented, Capcom decided they would want to please both audiences with Resident Evil 6, the horror fans and the action fans, although I'm pretty sure there weren't any action RE fans to begin with, and what we got was a complete mess of a game that didn't please either side. The story was lame, and the campaign was all over the place and uninteresting, and it was very unstable. The writing was awful, and the game was just the complete opposite of what people wanted from a Resident Evil game. Fans also weren't happy that Capcom execs responded to the negative criticism of the game by saying that they knew better than the fans, and that if they always did what the fans wanted, they would never make any progress. Who says that? At number 3, we have Ju-on the Grudge. Most everyone knows about The Grudge the movie, but not as many people know that the American version of The Grudge is actually a remake of a Japanese movie called Ju-on, which is arguably even scarier. This game is based on the Japanese version of The Grudge, with some elements from the American version thrown in as well, and it was released for the Wii in 2009. Yep, you heard me right, a horror game on the Wii. It's played in first person as you venture around the house and use the Wiimote to guide your flashlight as the creepy Grudge Girl chases you around. It's bad. Bad graphics, dumb, unresponsive controls, unscary, and super short, and the game definitely doesn't do the movies any justice. In fact, it says on the box art that it is a haunted house simulator. Really? Haunted House Simulator. That's the snappiest description that they could come up with. At number 2, we have a title simply known as Amy, and this was released for the Xbox 360 and PS3 digital arcades in 2012. Amy is a survival horror game with some stealth elements when you're asked for it, when you're supposed to protect and assist a young girl named Lena during a zombie outbreak. But for some reason, Amy and Lena are both immune to the virus, and I never fully explained in the game. You're just expected to accept that the main characters can't be infected, and the whole game is kind of like that. Nothing really makes sense. Not the story, the controls, the countless bugs, nothing at all. Remember all the lame escort missions in video games that you've played, where you have to make sure someone gets somewhere safely, but the person you're escorting is the stupidest being on the planet? Well, that is this entire game. I would say never play Amy. If you want a good escort horror game, go play Resident Evil 4. All right, we've reached that point. Did you guess what the number one title was today? We have Alone in the Dark Illumination. Now, we've talked quite a bit in these top 10 videos about the Alone in the Dark series, usually for bad reasons. Meet the worst one of all. Released in 2015, Alone in the Dark Illumination single-handedly destroyed the franchise with what became known as the worst survival horror game ever created. The game was developed by a studio called Pure FPS and let you play with up to three of your friends as you tried to battle your way through monsters and demons with light sources as your ally. The concept was okay, with the whole light source thing being somewhat interesting, but the game is horrible. Glitchy, boring, repetitive, terrible sound design, no voice acting at all, horrible AI, this game is just trash. You can't enjoy its badness, just don't try. Go away, Alone in the Dark. Atari, just let the franchise die in peace. And there you have it, my friends. Those are 10 of the worst horror games ever made. Let us know where we got it right and wrong. Which ones did we miss? There's a playlist below if you want to check out all the other top 10s that go up on the channel. Be sure to be subscribed, and I'll see you guys on the next video.